good morning. I hope you're toasty warm in your homes this morning for our online service. And you're probably as surprised as I was to wake up the other day with about 15 to 20 centimeters of snow in our yards. Not so surprised as my son, who realized, I think, that his chore schedule just got a little heavier for the winter months. Today, we are going to continue in our series, The Sermon on the Mount. This is our eighth sermon on the Sermon on the Mount. And we're going to talk about worry today, because worry and fear are something that we all struggle with, don't we? We all worry and we fear about so many things, and so many things that we literally don't have control over. But the title is in a question. How can we overcome worry and fear? How can we overcome worry and fear when it's something that we all struggle with? But I wanted to start with a story. John Wesley was walking with a troubled man one day. They were walking down the road, and this man was expressing his doubts as to the goodness of God. He said, "I don't know. What shall I do with all this worry and trouble that I carry?" And at the same moment, John Wesley saw a cow looking at them over a stone wall. "Do you know," asked John Wesley, "why that cow is looking at us over the wall?" "No," said the man who was worried about everything. Wesley responded by saying, "Well, the cow is looking over the wall because he can't see through it." That's what we must do with our fear, our wall of trouble, is look over it to avoid it. Look at something else. We need to look at our faith, because it's our faith that enables us to look past circumstances and helps us focus on Jesus Christ. So today we're going to continue with the Sermon on the Mount. As we've been going through, it's so interesting to look at Jesus's teachings. I watched a TV series. I just finished the second season of the TV series, The Chosen, this past week. And it was really interesting to watch this series. It was really, it's a great series. And it gives a different perspective into the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ. But the second season is leading up to and culminates in the Sermon on the Mount. So I thought it was very fitting that I finish the second season at this point. And I thought it was really interesting because he's practicing in one of the episodes, he's practicing the Sermon on the Mount. And Matthew, who's taking notes and writing the sermon down, is giving him some of his thoughts. And he says, "Well, it seems pretty challenging," in which it is. The Sermon on the Mount is very challenging. But he says, it's pretty challenging. And Jesus, or the actor who plays Jesus, takes a step back and says, "You're right." And he goes off and he thinks about it. He comes back, he says, "I figured it out, Matthew." He said, "The Sermon on the Mount is like a map. A map. In order to find Jesus, we need to find people who are like the people in the Sermon on the Mount. Those people, those characters in the Sermon on the Mount will be congregating around Jesus. People who are peacemakers. People who are meek, the comforters. People who seek after God's own righteousness, the poor in the spirit, the pure in heart, or those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Those are the type of people who congregate around Jesus. So if we want to find Jesus, we need to find those types of people, and we'll find Jesus. The Sermon on the Mount, it's not a feel-good message. It's actually very challenging. At its core, the message challenges the status quo that everything we believe in has to change. We cannot, if we want to follow Jesus and his teachings, we cannot live like we've always lived. We need to change and become more like him. And like I've said before, the Sermon on the Mount changes this world, or turns this world upside down. It goes to the very core and the heart of every person on the face of the planet. And in this part, or this section of the Sermon on the Mount, it challenges worry and fear. We worry about everything. There was a survey done, and I wrote these down. There was a survey of about 2,000 people, and they were asked what was the most things that they worry about. And listen to this list, you guys. They were worried about the area they live in and the crime levels. I can put my hand up to that one, because We were looking at the same thing not just a month and a half ago, I think. People worry about their pet's health. Their pet's health, of all things. People worry that their dress sense is good. Maybe they don't want to wear it, have any fashion faux pas, so they dress in only bland colors. I don't know. People worry about meeting their work targets and their goals at work. They worry about whether they're a good parent or they're raising their children right. People worry about a friend or a family member that they've fallen out with in the past. People worry about whether they're going to find the right partner or not. Or they worry whether their current partner is still in love with them. People worry whether they're attractive or not. People worry about having to find new jobs. And I can say I've worried about that in the past. I remember reading the book of Job because it was spelled job, thinking maybe that will help me get a job. People worry about being unhappy. People worry about paying their rent or their mortgages on time. People get worried about their physique. They worry about wrinkles or aging appearance. Job security, there's a big one. Most of us have probably can all put our hands up worrying about job security. How about financial or credit card debt? People worry about that. People worry about their diet. How about low energy levels? People worry about their low energy levels. People worry about their savings or their financial future. Am I going to have enough money to retire with? People worry about these things. And people get worried about getting old in general. I don't know about you, but I've thought about it. Of all the worries on this list, we haven't even touched on global warming or COVID-19. That was left out of the list. But we worry about anything and everything. So let's read what Jesus has to say about worry in Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 to 34. You can follow with me on the screen, or you can read it in your own Bibles. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more like food, and the body more like clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Can any one of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your life? Why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers in the fields grow? They don't labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you? You have little faith, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat or what shall we wear? What shall we drink? For the pagans, they run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow has enough worry for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Wow. You know, it's been said, I read this, that one of the most repeated phrases of the entire Bible, and it's repeated 350 times or more, is do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. In some variation or another, this is the most repeated phrase in Scripture. God said it to Gideon when he called him to lead Israel. God said it to Jeremiah when he was called to be the prophet to the nations. God said it to Joshua when he led the people into the promised land. Jesus said it to the women at the day of his resurrection. The book of Philippians says, don't be anxious about anything. And would you believe it? Adam in the Garden of Eden added a new word to his vocabulary when he said, I was afraid. Now, today, mankind continually lives with fear. We fear failure. We fear success. We fear death. We fear life even. How can we overcome fear? That's the question. That's the title of the sermon. How can we overcome fear in our lives? The Apostle John said it best, I think, in John chapter 4, verse 18. It says, perfect love drives out fear. So fear has become the norm, the normality in our lives today. And John says, it's because there's an absence of love. Because if we have love, perfect love drives out fear. It's no wonder that our relationships with God and other people are fractured, because we're missing the most important key point, is love. In Matthew chapter 6, just before, remember we looked at this last week, Jesus commanded his disciples not to worry about their needs, what they eat or drink or wear. And right before that, he says that we shouldn't store up treasures on earth, but in heaven. We shouldn't be consumed with trying to store up wealth, because that just brings more worry. We have to deal with it. We have to look past the wall of fear and anxiety and worry in our life. Look beyond it. Look to Jesus. He promises us God will take care of everything else. All you have to do, all we have to do, is seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. This brings us right back to the beginning with the Beatitudes. Do you remember? To be blessed, to be approved by God, is to be meek, to be peacemakers, to be humble, to be poor in spirit. And here he's saying, don't worry. God's going to take all of that away and take care of all of your needs. We don't need to store up treasures, because that's just going to add more worry. If we get a new phone, don't we worry we're going to drop it on the ground and break it? The more we get, the more we start to worry. We need to look past the worry and look to Jesus. This isn't to say that we shouldn't be concerned about things in our life, because fear and concern are not the same things. Concern helps us to be diligent and prudent. We ought to be concerned about our loved ones being protected, their safety and their security, shouldn't we? We ought to be concerned about where we go, what we touch, wash our hands, because these are responsible concerns. But worry, when the situation gets too big, worry takes us out of control and takes over. That we're no longer controlling a situation, but the situation controls us through worry. We need to look beyond that stone wall. My wife, being an athlete, she once said to me, and it sticks in my mind so much. When you're an athlete, a top level athlete, and you want to win the gold, win first place, win whatever championship you're in, a top level athlete never focuses on where they're going to make mistakes. They will picture in their mind the perfect run, or the perfect game, or the perfect competition, because that's what they're trying to achieve. What's perfect for us in our life? Jesus. Without Jesus, we have nothing. It reminds me of this story called The Burden. The Burden. It's a story about two monks. So follow along with me. Two monks were returning to the monastery in the evening one day, and it rained. There was water puddles all over the sides of the road. And at one place, there was a beautiful young woman standing. She was unable to cross the road because of a large puddle of water. The elder of the two monks, he went over, he lifted the young lady up, the beautiful young lady, lifted her up, carried her over to the other side of the road, put her down so that she could continue on her way. And the two monks continued on their way back to the monastery. Later on the evening, the younger monk came to the older and said, "Sir, as monks, we cannot touch women." The elder monk answered, "Yes, brother, you're correct." The younger monk asked again, "But then, sir, how is that you lifted the woman on the roadside and carried her over the puddle of water?" The elder monk smiled at the younger and told him, "Well, I left that young, beautiful woman on the other side of the road. The problem is, you are still carrying her in your mind." How can we overcome fear and worry? I'll repeat the phrase that John Wesley said to the man who was struggling over his worry and fear. Faith. Faith enables us to look past our circumstances and focus on Jesus Christ. That's how we can overcome fear and worry in our life. So as we take communion today, let us remember Jesus Christ. Let us remember his incredible sacrifice. We will take the emblems, the body and the blood of Christ, which help us to focus on the blood, which forgives all of our sins, and the body, which is his family, the church. With those two emblems, with Jesus's body and with his blood, why do we need to worry about everything else? Let's go to our God in prayer. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity we have to take the body and the blood of Christ today, to remember the forgiveness of all of our sins, to remember that he is perfect, the example that we need to follow. Help us to remember, to reflect, and to be grateful always that without Jesus, we have nothing, but with him, we have everything. And that you, Father, you take care of all of our needs. There's no need to worry. There's no need to have fear, because you are there beside us every step of the way. Thank you for your son, Jesus, and his incredible sacrifice. It's in his name we pray. Amen.